Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. You have landed in plenary two, and it concerns freedom of information as a fundamental freedom and human right. I am Albana Shalla. I am program coordinator at Free Press Unlimited, a Dutch organization that supports independent media. And I'm also chair of IPDC. IPDC stands for International Program for Development of Communication, and it is an intergovernmental program of UNESCO. UNESCO's position when it comes to the right to freedom of information, has two dimensions, the right and the access to the right and the media literacy around the right. Now, today's discussion will focus on the right because to receive and to seek and to receive information and what we consider as part of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and is defined as the right of free expression. Now, maybe a few words, because this is the morning, about house rules and about what will happen in the coming hours of today. At 1 o'clock, the conference will be closed in this same hall with the adoption of the Finlandia Declaration. You have received it via email last night, and there will be copies available. They are being made now outside this hall for us to see, and that will be followed with a handover ceremony. This is taking place from between 1 o'clock and 2 o'clock. So you are expected to be here at the closing session of the conference. What I can personally say about the idea of the freedom to access information. I'm originally Albanian, and when I've been brought up in a dictatorship, and when we were looking at how what brought the change in the country, among the internal factors that brought the change to the country, we always looked at the role that RAI, the Italian television, played in the life of the Albanians. We were hungry people, and we were people also hungry for information. And that type of existence of living under a dictatorship very much resembled to me what Carl Sagan said when the Voyager sent the phonographs, sent them into space in 1977. They said, this is like a bottle being sent in the cosmic ocean. And that was the messages that we received then from the RAI television, which for us were like receiving something from a bottle from the cosmic ocean, and the cosmic ocean was the rest of the world. I've been living now half of my life in a democracy. I've been living in the Netherlands, and I've sought information. I've learned to use my right for freedom of expression and to seek information. And I also think that for people who have been living in a dictatorship, it takes time for them to learn how to breathe freely, how to speak freely, how to think freely. And that is also reflected in sometimes in the way of how we do things in life. For example, instead of seeking for information through the front door, going through the back door, or instead of talking directly, talking indirectly because of the fear of being persecuted. So these are things that stay with us, and these are rights that we are born with, but we are not aware with, and that is the state of the world. I have the privilege of being in here with experts who come from democratic countries, from Finland, the country that is hosting this conference, from Paraguay, from Canada and Nicaragua. So what we will do, we will exercise our right to freedom of expression, and we will have an expert's view on actually the rights, basically why the right to freedom of information matters, who are the actors in this complex world, and how are we going to exercise our right to freedom of information? What influences our decisions, what influences our thinking now compared to 10 years ago, 20 years ago, when the world did not have internet, when there were maybe less journalist skills, when there was less research done about the right to freedom of information? So I would start by introducing the panel. And first of all, I would give the floor to a veteran in a legal expert that you saw in the previous panel, but he's with us also now to round up this discussion about rights and access to information, Mr. Tommy Mandel. And he is executive director at the Center for Law and Democracy. and he will tell us about how this, what have been doing, so what we have been working on from the beginning after the adoption of the Human Rights Declaration, about where the freedom of expression is mentioned, and up to now. And then we will follow with the other experts. So we will build then on Toby's main story. Floor is yours.
Thank you. So I've been asked to set the scene a little bit, and I'm going to go back in history and then end up with a little bit of future thinking. So I think everybody by now must have heard that the first right to information law, I call them a right to information law because now it has been established internationally as a human right, so that seemed to me more appropriate terminology. The first right to information law, this is the 250th anniversary. It was indeed in this territory that that law was adopted, and that's why we're having this World Press Freedom Day here in that theme. It was essentially another 200 years before the next law was adopted. I should mention that what we classically consider the second law is actually the Finnish law, because there was a joint territory and then Finland, as an independent entity, adopted its own law in 1951. But the second law, sort of technically, I guess, second law was United States in 1966, fully 200 years after the original one. Activity has picked up a little bit since then, I'm pleased to say, and if I could have slide one. Yeah, there we go. So this is a graph of the chronologically graphed adoption of right to information laws up until 2014. We have today 108 laws, and as you can see, sort of the progress was a little bit slow, and then around 1997, the curvature or the gradient of the graph increases sharply, and taking us more or less at a constant rate of growth to where we are today. And if I could have a slide two. By 25 years ago, so a tenth of the period to the first law, all but one of the laws were in Western countries, and this graph shows the adoption of the laws by region. You can see at the bottom end of the graph in 1980, pretty much it's developed countries only with laws, and as you can see now, every region in the world has these laws. The penetration rates are different in different regions. The Arab world is probably the lowest percentage of penetration. Africa still growing strongly in Africa, actually, but a little bit weaker. LAC, by the way, is Latin American Caribbean. In the same 25-year period this graph shows, we have seen a few other very important developments. The digital revolution took place in that period as well, and that meant that this rapid increase in the number of right to information laws has been accompanied by a few parallel developments driven to largely, I would say, by the digital revolution, a massive growth in proactive disclosure of information. So, the laws focus largely on reactive. You can ask and receive, but proactive, fueled by digital, capacity. A key new idea, or as part really of the proactive disclosure, the idea of open data, that we should get this information for free in open formats and free to reuse as we might wish. The proliferation of a number of parallel movements, of which the Open Government Partnership is probably the most famous. And very, very importantly, as I kind of mentioned in my beginning comments, recognition of the right to information as a human right. And that, perhaps surprisingly for some people, really has only happened in the last 15 years. For those of you who were here in the first panel, we presented the Joint Declaration. The very first Joint Declaration in 1999 asserted, essentially, a right to information, and it was one of the first authoritative statements about that. Now we have several courts, international human rights courts, have recognized it, and I think it's fairly clear that it's a human right. Looking forward very briefly, and I understand that this is a kind of a very rapid run through things, what we would like to see in the, I won't say next 25 years, I'm going to collapse it to the next 10 years, but we still have, of course, another 90 or so countries that don't have laws. You know, we need to work to get laws in all of those countries, and even a much smaller number of countries that have constitutional protection, so we should like to see a strong growth in the constitutional protection. Implementation remains a challenge, I would say, in probably in every single country, certainly in almost every single country. My own country, Canada, has had a law since 1982. And I have to say implementation remains a serious problem there. And then finally, I think what we would like to see, we've had the digital revolution, but we have not really seen that entering fully into the RTI space, and we would like to see more RTI by design. Real-time updating of information, real-time generation of metadata about the information holdings of public bodies, tagging of information for more sophisticated searching possibilities, and I would also say building in automated tools for removing sensitive information, particularly private information, which really slows down the right to information. You know, you make a request and then they go through and manually remove, you know, every reference to a human being in it. You know, sort of technologies can help a lot to make the whole thing much more rapid. So I think, you know, we could see a real the second wave would be this growth in using digital technologies to really speed up and make much more efficient the whole process. Thank you.
Thank you, Toby. Now, again, we have slowly got into nowadays, and I would like to invite Professor Markus Uksi to talk about how we access information now and what are the challenges. And how do we access information at national level, but also thinking about the global aspects of it. I've just yesterday received your book that you produced with all the documentations about the access to information, and I think that book has been made available here, so further to this, you can always go and get the exact research that has been done on the subject. The floor is yours. Thank you,
Albana. Yes, indeed. In this whole context that was presented by Toby very eloquently, I think very well, what we see today, if I get my first slide on the screen, what we see today is lots of leaks. We have NSA leaks, the WikiLeaks, the Lux leaks, the TTIP leaks, the last one. But certainly, freedom of information should not depend on the willingness of someone, civil servant or an employee of a corporation, to commit the crime. That cannot be the essence of it. I grant the need, of course, of legal protections to whistleblowers, but from the vantage point of the ordinary citizen, obviously everyone should have access to information held by public authorities. That should be the main principle, and only a few narrow limitations to general access should apply. Now, all of this was somehow laid out already early on, as Toby said, 250 years ago. In fact, earlier, through the theoretical work of Peter Forskål, who built up a relatively coherent theory of the free society, and did so not only by saying that there should be a free press, but combining that free press and right to free press with another right to access official documents. So this combination of the two was essential from the beginning. Anders Tudenius, who was the political activist member of parliament in the Kingdom of Sweden, he wrote down these tenets that were floating around in the society at that point, and in his political work also combined free press with access to official documents. I think that is the invention that we need to keep our eyes on, also with a view to the future. Now, as Toby said, around 100 states have statutory provisions on access to information held by public authorities. A lot less states have constitutional provisions that formulate that access as a constitutional right of individuals. And I think that is significant. We should have more of those countries. At the same time, of course, we have a number of courts at the national level who have formulated right of access as an individual right. But I think I would like to bother you with the Constitution of Finland in this context and with Section 12, where in Section 12, subsection 1, you find freedom of expression. But in Section 2, you have this corollary of freedom of expression, the right to access official information as a complementary provision. So we find the two norms parallel to each other in the Finnish Constitution. Can I have the second slide, please? And this section 2 of subsection 2 of section 12 is interestingly constructed. There is everyone's right to access public documents and recording. This means without any respect to be paid to the medium. It could be data, it could be printed papers, it could be written decisions. And that should be those documents should be public under all circumstances, unless they have been, for compelling reasons, specifically designated as pieces of information that should not be given out. What we see here is that the two norms, free expression and access to public documents, appear together. They support together, and in particular, from the point of view of journalists, they give the journalists the tools to carry out their profession in a most efficient way. It's not only for the private citizen, but also for the journalist, obviously. And the next slide, please, which is my final slide. When we turn to the global level of international human rights, we actually find very little or almost no binding norm that would stipulate access to information as a human right. I think we find a lot of norms on freedom of expression, but we don't find this complementarity of access to information explicitly formulated in a way which would be natural, at least from a Nordic, Finnish, Swedish point of view. And I think we should still aim at improving our system. With a view to what has been until now, through the special rapporteurs, through General Comment 34 of the United Nations Human Rights Committee, we should keep this trajectory moving and aim at some point in the future of having also an explicit norm on access to public information available. I think that is not yet forthcoming. There's something at the regional level available, as in the Council of Europe, but this is still something we need to work on. The aims, of course, here are important. We want to reduce arbitrary action by government concerning release of information. This should always be the aim. But at the same time, by these access norms, we should enhance the freedom of expression and, at least as importantly, the right to participation of individuals in public life. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. As you see, we have a gender-balanced panel. And our next speaker will be a distinguished journalist from Paraguay, Mabel Reinfeldt. She is an investigative journalist, and she has been using the right to freedom of expression, and she will tell us about how this was received in her country, also considering the fact that it concerns global issues and also considering the fact that it has to deal with what you said, the right to participation. Mabel, the floor is yours.
Okay, good morning, everyone. I hear so many beautiful words in these days, but these words doesn't mean nothing in some places of America. more than that in Latin America, which you have to face the security, the reality of government pressures, drugs, violence, poverty, and no minimum standards of salaries and safety conditions to work. For me, it's very hard to talk about freedom of expression because we have to be ready in our countries to live every day with the fears to die. And why did I say this? Because we, as investigative journalists, we are ready to die. I think most of us are, we are really ready to do that. But when it happens to your friend, to your colleague, in your newspaper, that's hard to live every day with the fear to happen to you. Last year happened to a friend of mine. The name is Pablo Medina. He was assassinated in a little town near to the border with Brazil because drug trafficking. I was on the radio. Someone told me that I have to give the news, and I was the first one to give the news that my friend was assassinated. All the days he used to say, "Mabel, I'm afraid to die." And I said, "Come on, man, who's gonna kill you? You live in a little town where nothing happened." "No, I'm afraid. I'm seeing a lot of things there." And he was denouncing. And someday, just the death come. So speaking about freedom of expression in most of the countries of Latin America means death and murder yet. And let's take each case. We still don't have any law to support the access of information in Venezuela, in Argentina, in Bolivia, and in Costa Rica. We do have law, for example, in Ecuador or Nicaragua, but with many restrictions. Those governments find a way to block with other laws the right to access the information. In Ecuador, they find a law in 2013, and in Nicaragua since 2008. After the Panama Papers, Ecuador passed through a really nightmare because the same president took Twitter to expose all the journalists like criminals because they were working with those Panama Papers. Let's talk about Honduras. Honduras is another case of restrictions and journalists assassinated. This is a place where the government says that they can give access to documents because national security. You know what it means. Puerto Rico, they just give pieces of information like a puzzle. In Barbados, tension between government and press did not allow it yet to have this Freedom of Information Act. And in the United States, who's gonna believe this? They have the FOIA access, the mother of all the law, but they don't use it. And that's, there's not a daily practice to use the FOIA. That's the reason that they created this Sunshine Week to teach the people to use their rights, to teach about the risk of secretism in a country. As far we know, in the state of Virginia, very close to Washington, D.C., they are working right now to limit the access to public information. In my country, we have a law since 2014, but for example, still we can't get any access to, for example, the sworn declaration of our president, because they say that is because his security. And let's talk about the last thing, in Brazil. What happened in Brazil? Last Monday, a judge says that WhatsApp must stop for 72 hours. And what's that? Why is that? Because WhatsApp refused to give some information asked by the judge about a judicial case that involve drug trafficking. According to Inter-American Press Association, this is like if some journalist refused to give access to protect his source, and because that, the judge decided not to print the newspaper to distribute. And now, a colleague of Brazil who's here, Guilherme Alpendra from the Abragi, investigative journalist from Brazil Association, told me that right now WhatsApp is functioning right now. But that's the reality in Latin America. Thank you.
Thank you, Mabel. I'm sure there are participants in the room who will echo and might question or comment and have remarks on all what you have mentioned so far, because it goes beyond Paraguay, it concerns the whole continent. Now, as you might know, 28th of September is the day that UNESCO has proclaimed as the International Day for Universal Access to Information. And it is being recognized, and this year it will be the first time that we will celebrate this day. The celebration and this marking is an outcome of the African civil society advocacy. And it has had some good results on the continent. And I hope that the next speaker, Mr. Edetayan Oyo, the executive director of the Media Rights Agenda in Nigeria, will share his stories and will tell us what is happening in the African continent when it comes to access to information. Floor is yours.
Thank you, Madam Moderator. I think that one continent that has been rather slow in the uptake on this whole notion of access to information as a fundamental freedom and human right has been the African region. It was not until the year 2000 that we had the first access to information law on the continent when South Africa adopted its Promotion of Access to Information Act. And that was followed in 2002 by Zimbabwe, and subsequently by Angola, Uganda, and in 2008 by Ethiopia. And things seem to have stagnated there for a while. Now, if you remove South Africa from that equation, and you look at the other countries, and if you are familiar with their democratic practices, you may well wonder what was the motivation for them to have been the first among the first countries on the continent to have access to information laws. And that may also give you some insight into the quality of the laws that they had. So it became very clear very quickly that some drastic intervention was required for us to change the reality on the African continent. And there were a number of initiatives that were launched in an effort to change that reality. Firstly, to improve the number of countries that had access to information laws, to improve the quality of those laws, and to improve the level of implementation of the various laws. So I'll just quickly run through a number of those initiatives. One, first of all, was to try and establish a civil society hub that would provide a variety of technical support to civil society across the continent. So in 2006, a decision was taken to establish an Africa Freedom of Information Center, which would provide drafting, advocacy, monitoring, litigation, and implementation support across the continent. So that was one effort that was taken, driven largely by civil society. Another effort was to develop a model law on access to information, an initiative which was led by the Special Rapporteur on Freedom of Expression and Access to Information in Africa. And that was subsequently adopted by the African Commission, again to provide some standards for countries on the continent adopting laws so that we would not have laws like the Zimbabwean law, for instance, whose only relationship with access to information was the title. So it was hoped that that kind of model law would provide guidance. Then in 2009, a number of civil society organizations came together to launch the African Platform on Access to Information, with a variety of objectives, a long-term campaign to have a legally binding instrument that would give every African citizen a right of access to information. As you can imagine, that is not a task that is easily achieved, so it remains pending. But there were other shorter-term objectives, one of which was to establish some standards also in the form of a declaration to also guide legislative processes across the continent. And then also to embark on a campaign to set aside a day when the right of access to information would be recognized and promoted around the continent and globally. And I think perhaps that's where we've recorded some success in getting September 28, which had been proposed years earlier by the Freedom of Information Advocates Network. And this was then put before UNESCO, and UNESCO's executive board and subsequently General Conference proclaimed September 28th of every year as the International Day for Universal Access to Information. And that would now be celebrated for the first time this year. So hopefully we would agree on some clear objectives for that commemoration. But our hope is that it would help to advance the right of access to information around the world. But in terms of the situation on the continent, there's been a lot of progress since 2008. So we've moved from five countries having access to information laws to, at the moment, about 18 countries. The quality of the laws have significantly improved. I think Africa now has two of the laws on the continent being among the top 10 in the world in terms of the ranking that are done by the Center for Law and Democracy, as well as Access Info Europe. So that's, I think, some progress that has also been made. But that's only about 30% of the countries in the continent having access to information laws. So there remains a lot of work to be done in terms of making this right something that is acknowledged widely and respected across the continent. Implementation remains a significant challenge. In virtually all of the countries which currently have laws, implementation is very poor. It's at a very low level. I think that that's a problem that most countries around the world are experiencing. And I'm hoping that as we begin to commemorate an international day for access to information, we are able to come up with effective strategies for dealing with this problem so that the right is truly meaningful, not just around Africa, but across the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Edithan. To continue on this, we said that we will look at who are the actors, and there is in the access, public access to information helps to defines how open our societies are. And now, nowadays, in the contemporary debate about the public right to information, this private sector as an actor is very much part of the discussion. And I would like to ask Neela Banerjee, that is working as a journalist, and she is inside climate change, so you are an insider there. You to tell us a story about your work when it comes to how you can take corporations and how you can take the private sector and make them accountable and make them open and transparent to public access to information about what they are doing and about the present and the future, how they are affecting our lives. Sure. Sure.
Hi, so I work for Inside Climate News. If we could have the first slide, that explains a little bit about who we are. We're tiny, we're only 11 people with reporters and editors in different places. We have a virtual newsroom. We are a nonprofit and funded by foundations in the United States. You can go on our website. Our website is free. You don't even have to register to take a look around. We won the Pulitzer Prize a few years ago, and this year our work was recognized by many prizes, including being a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize for public service, which is the highest of the journalism prizes. And the reason we our work has had such resonance this year is because we looked at the role of the oil industry in discussing climate change, and specifically on ExxonMobil, which many of you know as Esso in your home countries. We worked in on an investigative project that relied on original internal documents from Exxon. And so this is about getting information from the private sector. And I've worked with FOIAs in the public sector, and I can tell you that, you know, there are peculiar challenges to working with corporations, which many of you as practicing journalists know. They are not under any obligation to give you any documents or information. If they're publicly traded, they'll have annual reports, but even that information is rather sketchy and spotty. So maybe if I tell you a little bit about our investigation and how we got the information we did, that case study might help. And I feel like as a journalist myself, I'm still learning about how to get information from the private sector. I feel like it's very much a patchwork approach. You try different things until you find something that works. So we were looking at a problem that is peculiar to the United States. As many of you know, the United States is the only country where we have a major political party that actively denies climate change, right? And the reason that this is, I mean, it's peculiar and embarrassing to us, but it affects all of you because this denial of climate change in the United States has prevented action on climate change for decades now, because the United States until recently was the major emitter of greenhouse gases. So why does this situation exist? And you'll have to forgive me if some of you already know this. The situation exists in large part because fossil fuel companies over the last 30 years have funded all sorts of think tanks that put out reports and have so-called experts that deny or cast doubt on the science of climate change. So that if you are a politician or you are a corporate executive, you can point to these seemingly very reputable organizations and say, look, you know, there's doubt about climate change. So it's held the United States in this sort of paralyzed position for years. All of that was very well known, right? And other people have written about it. So about a year and a half ago, we, you know, our tiny little outfit got together for an annual retreat, and we decided to look into what did the fossil fuel industry know about climate science, and when did they know it? Well, why do we think that they knew anything at all? For a couple of reasons. First of all, fossil fuel companies, especially the oil companies, hire some of the best scientists in the world. And secondly, because we knew that the European companies, especially BP, had scientists in the 1990s who were looking at this, and that the European oil companies, especially BP and Shell, were the first ones to actually openly accept climate change. The Americans were very slow if they acted at all. So we had this sort of knowledge. Well, what we ended up doing was launching an investigation that looked at fossil fuels. And very quickly, by last spring, that investigation had honed in on Exxon. And this is what we discovered. If you could please put up the second slide. What we discovered by talking to people and finding documents, which we have digitized and are on our website, is that Exxon had senior scientists briefing its board of directors as early as 1977, so long before the rest of the world knew about climate change, had them briefing their board of directors about the fact that that carbon dioxide in the atmosphere was rising, that it was being driven by the burning of fossil fuels, and that this posed a grave threat to human life on Earth. How did Exxon respond? Well, Exxon launched its very own, very ambitious climate research program. It was actually very rigorous. It was praised by industry, by the government, and by scientists. So this is, and they outfitted one of their tankers with equipment to measure CO2 in the atmosphere and in the oceans. And for a decade, Exxon participated in very rigorous science through the late 70s and in through the 80s, until late 1980s, it switched course entirely. And it ended up leading an organization called the Global Climate Coalition, which with other fossil fuel companies worked to stall or halt international action on climate change. So this came out in September, and you know, we just thought, like, you know, five climate nerds and maybe our mothers would be interested in this, right? The kind of resonance that this has had has been startling. So if you could just go to the third slide, please. What's happened since then is that the New York Attorney General has issued a subpoena for Exxon for decades of documents. The U.S. Virgin Islands Attorney General has as well. Others have also issued subpoenas for Exxon. We don't know. Some of the attorney generals on the state level have been quiet about it. Presidential candidates have spoken up about this. The Secretary of State has spoken about this. So, you know, this. So it's had a great resonance. So the question is, how did we get to this point? And like I said, you know, I'm still learning about this too. But I think when you're writing about corporations, you have nothing like a law, an international law that protects you. So what we did was we relied on three different things. There are public databases, and we can discuss this more later, that you can look at, especially if you're looking at something historical, that can yield documents. And from those documents, what do you get? You get names. A lot of those people may be around and not willing to talk to you. Some of those people may be dead, but some of them may want to talk to you. And that's how we got lucky. We found people who were willing to talk to us. And that person led to another person, and so on. And through that, we also gathered documents that are not in any, you know, archives anywhere. And we have digitized them, and you can go and find them. If there are practicing journalists here, you know, once we get to the Q&A, we can talk more about this process. But it can be done. If you're in an advanced democracy, you do not necessarily face a threat to your life, but you do face legal threats. You face threats of hacking, spying, you know, ruining your reputation. Those are threats that we live with. I'm sure people in countries where rule of law is not as strong as in the United States face far graver threats. So there's an enormous threat in taking on corporations, and in some ways there are fewer protections because they're not obliged to give you anything. So thank you for listening, and we'll take questions later, I guess.
Maybe on another round, Nila will tell something about her book, her publication, because it is available and she has copies with her. And
they're free, and I don't want to take them back to America. So please, there's like 25. Please come and take them.
Okay. Trying to reflect, you'd think that public access to information would be a gain-gain situation. So it will open up the societies, more transparency to the benefit of the mankind. The problem is that very often this is not considered as a gain-gain situation. And that's why we talk in terms of information war or propaganda. And that's why we divide continents and regions by the way of accessibility to that information. And that's why we also think about who are the losers and in this debate for public access to information. Now, the benefit of being 3 days in this kind of meetings is that you can hammer out the problem from different perspectives. And yesterday, there was a wonderful session organized where Helen Derbyshire was the moderator, and it was about freedom of information, but from a gender perspective and the other benefits to it. And this connects because when we are talking about public access to information, we have to think about who are those people who will benefit. And half of the world's population are women. And in that half, most of it is illiterate. And how are they going to access information? What kind of forms? Is it images? Is it words? Is it visuals? Who is going to bring the information to them? And this connects with a very big theme, which is UN, which are the UN, and which are the UN SDGs, so the Sustainable Development Goals. Now, these are goals that are put together by the good guys, by the guys who wants to see a better world. But what does this mean in reality? And I think I would like to ask the panelists how to connect what we have discussed so far with the SDGs, how these SDGs are going to trickle down at country level, how would Hungary, illiterate, women benefit from public access to information? How would an elderly person benefit from public access to information and to implement the right? And how to make this trickle down to real people, so in the end they do not remain the goals of the people around in this room, but they are the goals that these other people will benefit from. Please try to reflect in this line and also on what has been said by the previous speaker, so that, and then we open the floor for discussion. Marcus, do you want to say, Professor?
This is a steep challenge for me to start. Oh,
that's an easy one.
Well, that's good that somebody else will be able to say something more than I. I was impressed by the fact that you started off by saying that you actually grew up in a dictatorship. You have first-hand experience of how access to information is not working, but rather it's the opposite. You do not get information, you get perhaps rumors of all sorts. And that will then, of course, create a particular
And propaganda.
Flavor and propaganda, which will then create a particular flavor and mode of existence in that sort of a society. I was very impressed by all the contributors, and in particular by Mabel's personal reflections on killings of colleagues. This is not a good situation. Thinking about Neela's presentation, I was struck by the fact that these corporations in the oil industry knew about climate change already before anybody else did. There's a parallel to the tobacco industry here, which also knew before anybody else knew. And I guess nobody could do anything about that. Nobody could access that tobacco information either. So I guess we are stuck in this difficulty in regulating from the point of view of access to information the private sector. This will be a difficulty, and I doubt we can go very far into that, because it will probably affect very fundamentally the building blocks of our societies, which is not supporting complete disclosure of data from corporations and companies.
I mean, my response to that would be that, you know, to your point, Albina, but how does it help that illiterate woman, is that when you hold corporations accountable, right? I mean, it is the emissions. I mean, we actually quantified the emissions of Exxon over these last 30 years when they knew about climate change but continued to stall action on it. It was a vast amount. I mean, it's like some countries have spewed. And the point is that when corporations are held accountable, It may not help that woman who is alive now, but it could help her children or her grandchildren, meaning that if companies know that they will be held accountable for their actions and they start feeling pressure and they have to do something about this because of legal action or action by their shareholders, then they might think twice about it. You know, it is about accountability, and it is about impunity. You know, it is not the impunity that, say, drug dealers have in killing journalists or activists. It is the impunity that corporations have to behave in a certain way. And so I'm hopeful that if you pressure a corporation on one side, that others may wake up to and say, you know, we have to do something about this. And by the way, what we discovered was it wasn't just Exxon that knew. You know, they all knew starting in 1977. And we've done stories since then that show that they knew as far back as 1968. You know, so it just goes on and on and on. And the scrutiny, I think, helps to get them to clean up their acts so that, for example, climate change, the worst effects of climate change can be avoided. At least that's my hope.
Thank you. I would like to ask Toby to build up on this.
Yeah, I mean, I think with the exception of a very small number of countries, like India, for example, mostly up to now, right to information has not been what I would call a grassroots right. It is media, it's the politicians, it's businesses, it's NGOs that are using it, and not too much ordinary people. And I think that, there's a serious risk that sort of with this digital revolution and with, you know, societies really fundamentally changing their relationship to information. Right to information laws may become less and less relevant. But if they make that digital jump that I was kind of, in my forward-looking comments, in my first statements, was outlining, I think that they could totally reverse that. If the young people can go on, make a request, through their digital devices, get back responses quickly, get what they want, whatever, that could really empower this. And then I think, in the more grassroots sense that you were looking at, you were talking about, I think it could really change. In the previous panel, the word dinosaur came up, and I'm not going to repeat the context for that, but I'm not sure that whoever that reference was to, those dinosaurs are going to move that way. But I think for the young people, it really will make a big difference. You also mentioned about the SDGs, and obviously SDG 1610 refers to this, and they are looking at indicators for the SDGs, and one that has been proposed and I think largely accepted for 1610, there are two of them, and one is the adoption and implementation of constitutional, statutory and or policy guarantees for public access to information. So that could potentially be a very powerful support system for access to information if in the way that those indicators are applied and measured, it is done in a proper substantive way. When they say adoption and implementation, if adoption means adopting any law, no matter how crappy it is, then there won't be any substance to that indicator. But if that means, adopting a decent law, and we both mentioned the problems with implementation, it means that, we're going to seriously measure implementation. It has to be proper, or you're not going to get the tick on this this indicator. I think that could really, but we need to make sure that the indicator and the way they're applied is genuine, or we won't achieve that goal.
Thank you. Yes, please.
So, speaking from the experience of my region, I think most of the countries that have adopted access to information laws have not done so out of any real conviction about their possibilities. In some cases, these have been conditions imposed by donors for aid packages or for loans. So they've just been done to fulfill our righteousness. In a few cases, civil society has somehow overwhelmed governments and then they went along, not because they believed in the capacity of information to transform societies, and so on and so forth. So I think the task we face is convincing policymakers that this is a good thing and that it's going to bring about development. In many countries where the levels of corruption are pretty high, there's a lot of anxiety among government officials that this will expose us. So that leads automatically to self-protection, to looking for ways to weaken the laws or make them ineffective so that those objectives would not be realized. I think if we can convince them about the real prospects of access to information laws, then there would be real thinking about how to make them work. At the moment, I think it's just how do we satisfy those who are demanding for these things without really making them work? And I think that that's the challenge we're facing at the moment.
Yes. Okay.
I would like to say that freedom of access is not a Christmas tree to use just from time to time, like a gift, It's an exercise, it's a gym, it's an everyday gym. And the most important thing is not only to make law to access information. Most important is to know how to use it, and not only women, but every citizen, not only journalists, teach the citizen to use it. And more than that, use it, and most that anything to make that authorities of our countries respect our right to use it. It's not a gift, it's a right. And we must learn that, and we must teach that. It's not a Christmas tree to use just from time to time. And I would like to say also that in this environment, they are very concerned because in Finland, now we have a really problem with the Finnish team. And why that? Because tax authorities are requesting their information about the Panama Papers. We are concerned why? Because they are...
What do you mean with the Finnish team?
Finnish tax authorities
yes,
are requesting the database of Panama Papers. And if it happens, will be a total risk for our countries. Why is that? It's going to be like a waterfall. Because if Finland forced to open that source and to reveal the source, could you imagine what it's going to be happening in Venezuela, for example, or in Ecuador, or in Paraguay, or Russia, for example, where Putin say that this is a war against him from United States. So this is a right. It's not a gift. It's an exercise, a daily gym. The freedom of access is something very serious, and we must take care of that.
There is a thin line, apparently, that is being debated again and again. So in the previous sessions organized here about the right to access information, public information, and what is a state secret and how much of it is it to be known. And I would like to ask Marco, as a native.
Thank you, Albana. This is an interesting topic, and I would like to agree with the ones who have said that there is always there are always implementation challenges. This is true in Nigeria, this is true in Paraguay, this is true in Canada, this is true in the US, and most certainly this is true also in Finland. A court practice from administrative courts, which I reviewed just days before I came here, indicate that there's a massive number of cases coming in, not only created by or appealed by journalists, but also by ordinary people. But very good cases also initiated and won, I should say, by journalists on important issues. So implementation challenges remain, and the reaction of public authorities will be perhaps intuitively one which is careful about not giving out information. But I think the main thing is that there are legal remedies which use in order to press for disclosure of public information. As concerns what Mabel commented about disclosure of the Panama Papers, as concerns the sources from where they come, I think the Finnish tax authorities are not interested in the sources. The Finnish tax authorities and the Finnish state and many other states are equally uninformed about what has taken place as any individual in Finland or in any country. So here I think the authorities and the individuals are on the same line. They also, the states have the interest and the need to know what has taken place in order to be able to enact legislation perhaps that prevents that sort of, in case there is improper movement of money, improper practices. Now, the disclosure request by the Finnish tax authorities, I believe, only concerns the mechanism and not the sources. So the sources should not be disclosed. I understand that the Finnish Broadcasting Corporation is saying that it would not be easy to take out the source information from these documents. They might be disclosed. So there's a kind of a very delicate balance here, but I think the tax authorities are not interested in the sources. Now, the tax authorities, in order to be able to get these documents, should be able to identify the persons or corporations these documents deal with. But I think that is information that is not known to the tax authorities, and that's why they're asking for them. Now, I think intuitively that they probably would not have the right to receive these documents, but so they would be, so to say, to be kept by the Broadcasting Corporation. But this remains to be seen. I hope that this will not lead to any disclosure of sources.
Yes. Okay. One final comment from Toby, and then we ask you to put maybe your questions. You can raise your hand and get to a microphone. Yes.
Well, firstly, wonderful metaphor that Mabel has put to us of this Christmas tree. But coming from a region where one of the main agricultural outputs is indeed Christmas trees, I just want people not to feel that there was any slight on Christmas trees themselves. But yes, keep buying our Christmas trees. I want to link this point about the relationship between openness and secrecy to a procedural issue, and also one of the points to ponder, which is about the appeal mechanisms. I was talking last night to somebody from Nicaragua, and Nicaragua has a wonderful law. I just checked, and it's 15th place on the right to information that Edison mentioned, that of course my organization and Helen's organization have produced, but it does not have an administrative appeal mechanism. So that means that if you ask for information, and the way that the secrecy line drawing works is you ask a public body for some information, and an official inside that body, who may or may not be in favor of openness, but quite heavily weighted against openness because it's their information, they don't really want to give it out, decides whether it's on this or that side of the line. Then in Nicaragua, you can go to court if you have enough money and resources and time and all of those things, which 99.9% of the time as a requester, you don't. But if you have a independent administrative body, an information commission, then the possibility of going to that body becomes much, much more for ordinary people. So I think it's an absolutely crucial part of the system. And I will say that, if we look at this in Canada, when appeals go to the information commission that are based on exceptions, so the public body has said, we can't give you information because it's exempt, it's secret, the overwhelming percentage those cases before the Information Commission are decided in favor of the requester. In other words, public bodies are systematically over-applying the exceptions. So I think that it's really, the procedural point is a really important one. I mean, we can get into the detail of how that line drawing is done. It's a sort of a boring legal thing, but the procedural issue I think is really important. So you need an independent and powerful Information Commission that can sort that out.
I hope by making it more complex, we have helped to make it also more clear. So now, let's try to get some questions. And I also have a question about the journalists when it comes to what they need to do in order to make us, to give us access to information. Do they have to be more data savvy themselves? And do they need to have more knowledge, the legal knowledge, exactly what Toby is saying? How many of us in the room know exactly how to go about this? But let's get for some questions and then we round up. We have 10, 15 minutes. Yes, please.
Hi, I'm Julie Pizzetti, a journalist and academic from Australia. I actually wrote a study for UNESCO about the protection of journalist sources in the digital age, which is hopefully going to be published very soon. And there's an extract in the book World Trends in Freedom of Expression and Media Development, and I'm saying this because in it we make some findings that are very relevant to the discussion about the Finnish situation with regard to the Panama Papers. And we had a session yesterday in which we discussed those findings. And one of them I'd like to point out is that there is a very real risk of exposing sources inadvertently through the handover of digital data. And that is a genuine and real concern, which I think we all should be alert to. And I take Mabel's point that when we make concessions as developed democracies on these issues, and when we don't defend those principles, we magnify the risk to others in states where the consequences are dire. So I do think the situation is relevant and serious in Finland, and that will play out. But the documents are not owned by the Finnish public broadcaster. They're owned by the International Coalition of Investigative Journalists. It's not their document set to hand over. But the fundamental principle is that when you access information in order to reveal stories in the public interest as a journalist, you frequently depend upon confidential sources, which is why I'm glad that the special rapporteurs referenced source protection in their declaration. So I guess a question to all of you is how you link these issues together, now that I've made the Finnish situation, how you link them together and how you acknowledge the digital risk involved in these processes as part of the freedom of information discussion.
Thank you for the comment and also for the question. Let's pick up two More questions? Yes, yes, please. Okay. Yeah.
My name is Hassan. Hassan Saeed is the head of the partnership organization Al Jazeera Center for Media for Human Rights and Public Liberties. Maybe my question is the same of my colleague, but I need to say just a few comments. It's very important to transfer all this information from the expert here to the journalists. If you know, how can we transfer this information from the concept, from the long report to journalists to tell them how can use it on the TV report? As you know, the TV report is just 2 minutes, and the report in the newspaper is very long. We need to think and to create something to do this report, to give the a few information, intensive information to journalists to transfer all this information for the audience. And my suggestion is, I think this is a good time to create a global coalition or a global alliance between the expert, the UN agency like UNESCO and International Press Freedom Organization, and journalists, individual journalists, to create a professional website, a professional manual training, and to do to organize the training course, to ask the media organization to organize the training, short training course, to explain the meaning of the access to information. In Al Jazeera, we have a short training course every month to tell our journalists how they understand and they transfer the breath of freedom. And now we need to explain, as my colleague said, we need to explain the meaning of this is access to information, and how can we use it in the different report, different documentary program and news.
Thank you for sharing that. For sharing the Al Jazeera experience. I'd like to like to ask Helen, because of the relationship between the two sessions. Sorry, and then we continue.
Thanks very much, Albana, and thanks for the excellent panel. I wasn't actually going to talk about the other session yesterday. I really wanted to see if I could get a little bit more from the panelists about this question of extending the right of access to information to the private sector. Because I think it's something we really need to look at. If we're talking now, as we are, about a right of access to information as a fundamental right. I think somebody said, maybe it was Marco, said that, you know, that would change the world. That's changed. My question is, hasn't the world already changed? Is it changing? And don't we need to ensure that this right change responds to and fits in with the realities of the world that we live in now? Which includes what we know about the responsibilities of huge multinational corporations, which are incredibly powerful, powerful and richer than many governments, and their impact on other rights, such as climate change, as has been explained. Or, as we heard yesterday on the surveillance panel, the incredible, phenomenal power which Facebook has and is grabbing more of year on year. I mean, the statistics from last year to this year about how many people get their news via Facebook rather than directly via newspapers' websites. We know nothing really about the algorithm.
Okay. Thank you.
So you get the point. But please, yes, if you could maybe look into the future a bit. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you, Helen. Also, this gentleman that has been looking at me.
It yes, was please. Exactly the same question. I'm from Brazil, and I would just like to add that maybe today the role that big corporation plays is the same role that states played 250 years ago. And it might be just as revolutionary to have this law now than it was 250 years ago in this very same geographical place. Thank you.
Okay. And you... Please, sir, and then we'll have to round up.
Ibrahim Saleh from Egypt. I'm academic and journalist. Very brief comments. I mean, thank you for the panel, but I'm a little bit concerned that, and I can echo with my colleague from Latin America, that I think we need to look differently about the same issues of access and freedom of expression. Where I come from is Middle East, and it is not enough to draft a law. It's not enough to have a legal framework that will ensure this wonderful idea of freedom and so on and so forth, because you have been having this kind of entrenched culture of fear, and culture and fear and the sort of accountability of having laws, it is a big, big, big difference. And just an example, without taking the time, it is still until today, 2016, it's more dangerous to cover local politics than covering war. So here is a big issue about that. The problem is that those stakeholders, the actors involved, most of the time they are either having conflict of interest, so they tend to sort of please the donors, like what my colleague mentioned from Nigeria, or they are just pleasing. At the end of the day, I'm not saying that there is a magic stick, but I would say that we need to consider the multiple layers that challenge any freedom that we're talking about.
Thank you. Yes, please.
Thank you. My name is Rivero Garcia. I'm from Paraguay. I'm here with the World Bank team that's conducting human rights research funded by the Nordic Trust Fund. My question is this. As civil society, I think we have been very effective in promoting access to information, the legal part of it, and in a way, giving ears to government, although we haven't been that effective or successful in really changing their mindset. But more fundamentally, have we forgotten to strengthen grassroots capacity to actually access this information, to understand it? And what is the role of press in doing so, connecting the grassroots movement in order to access and demand information?
Yes.
Thank you.
It has been echoed for a while now. One more question, and then I know that we are very keen to round up. It is a concluding remarks, but also responding to some of the questions for each one of the panelists. Yes, okay. Please.
This is Mustafa Suwak from Al Jazeera as well. I just want to add something that is connected exactly to what the media can do with the information. There is one very big problem everyone working for the media knows. When you have information sometimes, and it's in one way or another attached to certain people, companies, etc., if you put it in print or on screen or whatever, you risk having legal actions against you. In order to make sure that what you are doing is legal and you can defend your position and you don't get millions of dollars, you know, you are ordered to pay people, etc., you go to legal firms. Quite often, programs made about issues like this are more expensive, much, much more expensive. Using the programs themselves, because you have to pay, you know, the legal system, it's so expensive in so many countries. So I add my voice to my colleague Hassan. If we create some kind of an umbrella alliance, is it possible maybe to also find a way to help, especially companies, you know, media companies that are not, they don't have the funds to go through the legal system in order to actually use the information without being sued and sometimes actually led to bankruptcy.
Thank you. Okay, now before we take to the coffee break, we have a chance to listen to the final words of our panelists as a reflection on what has been said. Marcus.
Thank you, Your Honor, for this wonderful panel. The digital risk, I think, that's really a dilemma. I mean, all that digital information that was supposed to help us so much suddenly turns against itself. It's really problematic, and I think we can only try to work ourselves through it. But I think the bigger thing is that actually, as journalists, you want the world, and because these Panama Papers are now out, there should be some reasonable way to get that information to the governments who are interested also in stopping that dubious activity. So I think there's something here which is not working. Transfer knowledge from experts to journalists is a matter of training. And I think training is essential here. UNESCO is very much working in this. I think training packages could be done. Extending to the private sector, these publicity issues. I think that's a good idea to invite someone to stand in 250 years after Anders Chydenius to work out the next revolution of access to information. Let's hope that person will appear. I have my doubts, however, that we can go so far. into regulating or opening up private information. There are certain very difficult distinctions there that bother me, but I'm personally not against that sort of an extension. Strengthening grassroots capacity provide the financial means for taking cases to courts. I think that is important. I was speaking about the many cases that surface in Finland. They are carried out within the administrative process rather than in general courts, and that is very cheap and easy for the individual to utilize. So there are ways and means to arrange suitable processes, commissions or courts which have a more reasonable procedure. Thank you.
Thank you, Mabel.
Yes, I would like to say that, thanks God, I'm a journalist, because if I wasn't an authority, maybe I will not try to fight with journalists to have a database. I will be very concerned to open information of those corporations to the public. If you see these offshores, they were growing in our faces. I mean, it's millions or millions or millions of information growing in some part of the world, and no one says nothing. They didn't make anything about it, and now they are pressuring the press. So what is this? I mean, they didn't their work, and now they want that we do the work. So I will be very concerned about that. And I think that we must work for open all the information relatives to these kind of things. And to Marcus, just want to say that I understand very well that the name, the person, is the source, but our database is our source, and maybe the tax authorities of Finland doesn't know that on next Monday will we reveal the whole database with the names of companies and names of people involved in those companies will be revealed on next Monday. So they just must to do the work that they supposed to do in the past. Thank you.
Thank you, Mabel. Toby?
Yeah, I mean, others have talked about the Panama Papers. From my experience, one of the biggest claim digital risks is that people will take certain databases and mash them or combine them in innovative ways with other databases which have been supposedly anonymized and probe through and find the people, the private people behind that. I had a long conversation with a senior statistician at StatsCan, which is the national statistical agency in Canada, which releases thousands of data sets. And he told me that they have never in their whole history had any of their data sets privacy broken. And his view was that if the anonymization is done professionally and properly, he did not see the risk. So I think that, and I know there's some high-profile stories going around. I think that my strong suspicion is that those data sets were not properly anonymized. On the other side of the equation, I can see a growing threat from abusive application of privacy as an exception to deny information that simply should not be denied. I mean, I think that is the much greater risk. Absolutely, very, very important. My organization has several developed courses, and when I'm not out harvesting Christmas trees, I'll be happy to give a training course to Al Jazeera or anyone else who wants it. I think Hella's raised a very important point, and I think we need to really think a lot more about it. My organization is about to release a very major paper on the human rights responsibilities of online intermediaries. It's not about state action or coercive action, it's about their own responsibilities. It's full of statements about transparency and how they have to be transparent about this and that and the other, which they should do as part of their own responsibilities. And that's important, but it's absolutely not enough. If we look at the legal responses I think we can talk about two types of legal responses. We have the situation pioneered in Africa with the South African law and a couple of other African laws, whereby where people need information to protect or exercise a right that's held by a private corporation, they are brought within the access to information or right to information law in the same way as a public body. I think that that is something sort of hasn't really taken off globally, or even I don't think too much in Africa. Maybe you can mention, talk about that. But I think that's one angle to look at. We also have seen thematic obligations on private sector corporations, you know, to release certain types of information. But I think that we really need to get much more blue skies about this and you know, become much more radical and inventive about this, because, you know, I mean, it's not just Facebook. There's a growing panoply of companies that really wield enormous amounts of power and control our expressive space. It's not just, you know, I mean, they're dominating how we speak to each other, you know, and secrecy, that is absolutely a public function as far as I'm concerned. So we really have to, I think of much more powerful legal solutions, as well as the, you know, their own responsibilities.
Thank you, Toby. Indeed, until late last night, I've seen people tweeting and retweeting this morning again and again. So we are constantly into this world of sharing information. To Edton.
Okay, so let me say that I understand that the discussion about access to information is not primarily about the media or about journalists, but I have been hugely disappointed by the fact that the media has not been as engaged on this issue as it should be, and that it's been extremely difficult convincing individual journalists to engage the issue. I mean, I think they have a greater stake than any ordinary citizen, because media professionals use access to information laws in the same way that every ordinary citizen would. But they also have other responsibilities, I think multiple responsibilities in this area. First of all, a media person basically deals information. That's your core business. It's gathering, processing, and disseminating information. So this is right within your domain. But I think also the role of the media requires that they should be engaged in public enlightenment about access to information laws and how to use it for ordinary citizens. They should be monitoring implementation by public institutions, levels of compliance, and so on. And in those countries where media institutions are also covered by the laws, then they should also be complying with the laws in terms of their duties and obligations under the law. So I think that the media community really needs to increase its level of engagement in this issue, and I think ultimately that is how we're going to get increased levels of awareness within the wider population about the existence of these laws, about effective implementation, and so on. Across Africa, that engagement is largely missing at the moment, and I think it's probably the same in a lot of other regions. Thank you.
Thank you. Nila.
I wanted to talk about the questions on training and about corporations. And I think the notion of having more journalists trained to use freedom of information laws is a good one. The problem you face, though, is that freedom of information laws vary from country to country. They vary from state to state. They even in the United States vary from agency to agency in the way that they're applied. And so I think what I have found as a journalist very useful are my in-country, very practical training sessions about that are not just for a particular company like Al Jazeera, but sort of industry-wide, where investigative journalists get together and we share information about how to work the system. And to your point about legal protection, like I said, you know, we're small. Granted, we are in a developed democracy, and we are protected by lawyers who work for us pro bono or for free, and they have looked at all of the articles that have gone in here to make sure that we are not misrepresenting what the documents say so that we do not get sued. Also, in many developed democracies, you can buy insurance against libel so that if you are sued, you know, you have some insurance there. So there, you know, again, I know that in countries such as Egypt or in Latin America, you know, if it's hard journalists to work, it'll also be hard to find lawyers who'll be willing to work for you, risking their lives and reputations to protect you. But training is important, but I fear that going internationally is too difficult because of the specific conditions in every country. Now, as far as corporations go, I agree with Marku that it is very difficult. I hope that in 250 years, our descendants will be able to look back and say, "Oh, it was like like it was with governments." I do think that the conditions are very different, and the way that openness comes about is through the legal system, but also through shareholders. Shareholders are pressuring companies either through divestment or through shareholder resolutions. Just yesterday, we read that Norway's national fund, which it actually gets from its oil proceeds, is now pressuring Exxon to disclose more on its climate policies, which I find terribly interesting and ironic. But the point is that right now that is all we can rely on. What more we can do, I'm not sure of. I mean, in the end, what I've come away with in listening to people here is that whether it's with the government or with corporations, we are constantly involved in a cat and mouse game. We are trying to get information. They are trying to thwart us. And it is when we come together as practitioners especially, and with some lawyers, and we try to figure out how it is that we can get into that information before they try to block us off again. And I feel like it's going to be that way, whether you live in Egypt or the United States. They try different ways of silencing us and blocking us. But the point is that governments have a very ambivalent relationship with us as journalists, right? People want to say that they have freedom of press and freedom of expression, but when we actually try to exercise that, we are blocked. And so, it's important for us to share our ideas and to share our methods, and maybe our methods are not entirely applicable, like what I'm using in the United States to you in Egypt, but maybe, I can offer some information that will be useful to you, like an international database. Maybe you can offer some information to me, like use of databases or privacy technology, social media. So I think that's how we the mice win against the cats. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, I would like to thank the panelists for their experts' contribution to the issue. I would like to ask the contributors to thank the contributors and all the audience about intelligent questions, remarks, comments to the issue. It is very clear that we have enough food for thought, and we've put a little brick into that bridge of reaching each other and using our public access to information. And I hope we'll go home wiser, but also humbler and alert that we have something more to talk about and to work in our struggle for freedom of expression. Please get Nila's books there, and a fine day, and see you at 1 o'clock here in the plenary, if not in the other sessions, where the declaration, Finlandia declaration, will be adopted. And there are copies outside that you can pick up now and review in the meantime. Thank you, and applause.